2023 was the hottest year on record. Global warming wreaked chaos in the form of wildfires, droughts, heat waves, and heat-related deaths. This is not new. In 2022, 61,000 people in Europe died from extreme heat. Experts say heat deaths could quadruple by 2050 if temperatures rise 2 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels. In Singapore last year, the mercury hit a high of 37 degrees Celsius. And moving forward, we will face more such days of extreme heat. But what happens to our bodies in extreme heat? I want to measure the impact the heat has on our body. So I've come to the Heat Resilience and Performance Center at NUS for a little experiment.
So the first condition will be a hot and dry environment. 40 degrees air temperature and 40% relative humidity.
I'm going to be walking on a treadmill for 20 minutes at the speed of 4 kilometers per hour in these conditions. The team will be tracking my heart rate, skin temperature, and core body temperature using sensors attached to my body. Before I start walking, I'm asked to rate on a scale how hard I'm exerting and how hot I'm feeling. The team will then check in every 5 minutes to see if these values change. Halfway through, I start walking faster on an incline to further stress the body. It was definitely very hot throughout and my skin felt very hot. And then I started sweating like midway through the walking. One way the body loses heat during exercise is through increased blood flow to the skin. But this is difficult.
It was 40 degrees Celsius. And also that's definitely much higher than what your skin temperature was. Sweating is the main avenue of heat loss.
I'm taking a 30-minute break to cool down while the chamber is adjusted to the next set point. This time, it's going to be warm and humid.
We'll put you through that Singapore environment expressed in 32 degrees Celsius with about 75% relative humidity.
The dampness of the chamber made it more difficult to sweat effectively. Over time, I get more dehydrated and my blood volume decreases.
Your heart needs to work harder and harder to pump the blood to supply both the skin, vital organs, and the muscle.
If I continue in these warm and humid conditions, it can become potentially dangerous for me. I actually felt like I exerted more in the dry heat, which was quite surprising to me.
You definitely felt hotter in the hot and dry versus the warm and humid, right? Yeah. But the resultant physiological responses or strain were actually quite similar between the two conditions.
This was also reflected in the data. After walking, my skin temperature was about 3 degrees higher in dry heat compared to humid heat. But my core temperature was somewhat similar after both conditions. So although I feel less warm in humid heat, I may not know my body is exerting equally hard. It's rest and recovery time, but the team has a final challenge in store for me. Air temperature is also known as dry bulb temperature. When air temperature is combined with humidity, we get what is called the wet bulb temperature. 35 degrees Celsius is thought to be the threshold for the human body.
So it'll be 90% relative humidity with about 36.5 dry bulb temperature. That combination will give us that 35 wet bulb temperature. So that will be harsh.
Just 5 minutes in, I was beginning to feel like I was working out in a sauna, and it showed. Even the GoPro camera could not take the heat and blacked out halfway through.
As I went on, and as you increase the intensity, my heart was definitely working harder, and I was breathing a lot harder.
I survived, but just barely. My heart rate, core temperature, and skin temperature were the highest in this final condition. I also rated my perceived exertion and thermal sensation on the higher end of the scale by the time I finished the walk.
So what can happen in this sort of harsh heat conditions?
When you feel that lightheadedness, the drop in blood pressure, and therefore you feel like you want to faint, largely because the blood gets pulled at your lower limbs, right? And therefore lack of blood and therefore oxygen to your brain. So we call it heat syncope. Some people might say if that can progress to heat cramps, although in my opinion it just cramps when you work very hard, heat exhaustion, and then heat stroke.
Besides the physiological impact on our bodies, heat also affects our cognitive response. my focus is being tested in a virtual reality environment. Each time before and after my walk in the three different conditions, I had to complete a welding task and walk across a plank.
Definitely the second time around, I felt like my hands were a bit shaky doing the welding task. And I was still breathing very hard. So I guess the focus was not that precise as the first time.
Based on your subjective perception, you already felt that it was a little bit more difficult or uncomfortable after you are being heat stressed.
With rising temperatures, heat exhaustion will become more of an issue in the future.
How can we better acclimatise to the heat?
Heat acclimatisation is a progressive exposure to a certain level of heat strain. And over time, your body will adapt. So you get yourself fit, get yourself heat acclimatised, incorporate rest, cool yourself appropriately, drink sensibly. I think you have a good tool in your arsenal to beat the heat.
If you live in Singapore, you can refer to a National Heat Stress Advisory. It provides a guide on how to adjust outdoor activities, the appropriate level of hydration and attire based on the heat stress level at a given time.
Many of us complain about the weather, but how many of us really understand how dangerous it could be to our health? After what I went through today, I'll think twice about underestimating the severity of the heat, especially when I'm outdoors. After all, knowing how to deal with it may mean the difference between life and death.